Friends, welcome to this daily devotion. I'm Pastor Mark, and I have the privilege of serving the United Methodist Church of the Frankfort, Mokena, and New Lenox areas. I ask that you come to this time with an open heart and an open mind. Ready yourself that we may truly come into the presence of God and leave transformed as people living in abundant life. Hear the affirmation. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to weep, and a time to laugh. Ecclesiastes 3, 1 and 4. Our theme psalm today is Psalm 38, today from the New International Version. Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, or discipline me in your wrath. Your arrows have pierced me, and your hand has come down on me. Because of your wrath, there is no health in my body. There is no soundness in my bones because of my sin. My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear. My wounds fester and are loathsome because of my sinful folly. I am bowed down and brought very low. All day long I go about mourning. My back is filled with searing pain. There's no health in my body. I am feeble, utterly crushed. I groan in anguish of my heart. Let us pray. Gracious God, you know the sighs confined and hidden within the depths of our hearts, sighs for which there are often no words. Do not be far from us, O God, when we cry out to you. Hear our prayers today. Amen. Friends, our theme this week has been the gift of tears, and I imagine a challenging theme for some of us. Our anthology reading today comes from Trevor Hudson, Hope Beyond Your Tears. When we find Mary standing outside the tomb, she is weeping. 2 days earlier, she had seen the person whom she loved dearly, the one who she had released, who had released her from her torment, put to death on a cross. She had followed him around Galilee. She had been at the foot of the cross and accompanied his crucified body to the tomb in Joseph's garden. Then, early on Sunday morning, she had gone with a small group of women to the tomb. To their great distress, they found the stone rolled away and the body of Jesus gone. Soon afterwards, Peter and John arrived only to depart and leave Mary alone in the garden, standing beside her pool of tears. The longer I think about Mary's tears, the more I recognize the need for her to cry. She needed those tears to express the deep grief of her heart. They were necessary to ease the intensity of the inner pain. They were necessary to relax those raw nerves rapidly reaching the breaking point. They were necessary to lighten the weight of sorrow bearing heavily down upon her spirit. They were necessary for the process of healing and transformation to begin. Indeed, I believe that without her tears, Mary may have failed to recognize the shining figures inside the tomb. After all, tears can help us see things differently. They clear the dust from our eyes, give us fresh insight and vision. Amen. I truly believe if you want to learn how to follow Jesus, obviously the disciples, the 12 who we know, share paths with how we can do that. Paul is a good example, as our early church leaders in Scripture. But I think you can't neglect, and for many of us, following Jesus as Mary Magdalene did offers a path to fulfillment and enlightenment and perfect love in ways that maybe we are all too uncomfortable with. I love how easy it is to come to the end of Lent. Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, Easter Vigil, Holy Saturday, Easter morning, and not realize that Mary was there every step of the way, and in truth, really the only one who was. No doubt she was there at the Last Supper, probably helping prepare and work to serve that meal. She was there, we know, throughout the process, conviction, arrest, torture. She was there at the foot of the cross. But what we don't necessarily remember, or and it's just explicit in the Bible, it just says it. She was there when Joseph and Nicodemus took Jesus' body down. She was there and followed them to the tomb, probably helped. She was there when Joseph put his body in the tomb. And when Joseph, everyone else had left, it was Mary who stayed. The Bible doesn't say she wept then. Bible didn't say she wept at the cross. She waited. She waited. That's all we heard. I have some theories about what happened there, but she waited. And then she came back. And again, the Bible doesn't say she was weeping. And the tomb was empty. The stone was rolled away. She went and got the disciples. She came back. They ran, they left. And at that moment, in the midst of everyone just always leaving, and in the midst of maybe Jesus had left, she broke down. And in that moment of pure vulnerability, in that moment of pure humility, in that moment of pure true self, that's when she saw Christ risen. That's when the dust cleared from her eyes. Beautiful language. So much to learn from her example, the apostle to the apostles, Mary Magdalene. Our scripture reading today comes from 1 Samuel, starting in verse 24, or excuse me, 1 Samuel chapter 24, starting in verse 8. Then David went out to the cave and yelled after Saul, "My master, the king!" Saul looked back and David bowed low, out of respect, nose to the ground. David said to Saul, "Why do you listen when people say David wants to ruin you? Look, today your own eyes have seen that the Lord handed you over to me in the cave, but I refused to kill you. I spared you, saying, 'I won't lift a hand against my master because he is the Lord's anointed. Look here, my protector. See the corner of your robe in my hand. I cut off the corner of your robe, but did not kill you. So now know that I am not guilty of wrongdoing or rebellion. I haven't wronged you. But you are hunting me down, trying to kill me. May the Lord judge between me and you. May the Lord take vengeance on you for me. But I will not lift my hand against you. As the old proverb goes, evil deeds come from evildoers. But I won't lift a hand against you. So who is Israel's king coming after? Who are you chasing, a dead dog, a single flea? May the Lord be the judge and decide between you and me. May he see what has happened, argue my case, and vindicate me against you." As soon as David finished saying this to Saul, Saul said, "David, my son, is that your voice?" He broke down in tears, telling David, "You are more righteous than I am, because you have treated me generously, but I have treated you terribly. Today you've told me the good you have done for me, how the Lord handed me over to you, but how you didn't kill me. When someone finds an enemy, do they send the enemy away in peace? May the Lord repay you with good for what you have done for me today." Now even I know that you will definitely become king, and Israel's kingdom will flourish in your hands because of that. Make a solemn pledge to me, by the Lord, that you won't kill off my descendants after I'm gone, and that you won't destroy my name from my family's lineage." David made a solemn pledge to Saul, and Saul went back home, but David and his soldiers went up to the village, to the fortress, excuse me. God bless the reading of the Book of Samuel today. Yeah, I love the story of Saul and David. It's very Game of Thrones-esque. There's a lot of intrigue and other things that wouldn't be appropriate for Sunday school in that, in the midst of war and transition and lots of politics. I love it. It's great reading. And this relationship between Saul and David is very interesting. Saul becomes enraged, afraid, anxious, paranoid. Saul buys into conspiracy theories. David has shown nothing but love for Saul, for his king. David and Jonathan were best of friends. And Saul buys into things that aren't true. And he's led to madness, in a sense. Unfortunately, it's not an uncommon story in our world. But here in this moment, for a brief moment, Saul comes to his senses and breaks down. "David, my son, what have I done?" Sometimes the gift of tears is the clouds lifting from our eyes. It's the awakening to what have we become? What have we done? And all too often I've seen people destroy relationships, families, churches. And when they finally realize what they have done, it's often too late. Too late for reconciliation, too late for restoration in the temporary sense, not in the eternal sense. Don't wait. If there's blindness in your spiritual eyes, pray that you can see. Let the tears cleanse the dust so that if you're doing harm, you'll start to do good. If you're far away, you'll start to return so that you can love, grow in love, and be loved. Friends, today we practice prayers of intercession, praying for others. And to do so, we use our simple five-finger prayer. And I'll put it on the screen for you so that in silence you can pray for those closest to you, those in authority, our leaders, those who are weak, and finally, and most importantly, yourself. Let us pray the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I leave you with these words from John Wesley. O Lord, may nothing dwell in my soul, but your pure love alone, till my every thought, word, and act be love. Yes, Lord, may your love possess me whole. You're my joy, my treasure, my crown. Until next time, friends, God bless. Goodbye. Amen.